Episode 49 was with Kat Cunning.
She called us up from her New York City home, and she told us all about her dance, music, and acting career.
She also has a brand new song out today. It's called Broken Heart. It's amazing. Make sure to check it out.
Check out our YouTube page and Facebook at Bringing It Backwards, and our Twitter and Instagram at Bringing Back Pod. Follow us.
We're Bringing It Backwards with Kat Cunning.
Hello.
Hi, Kat.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm sorry I'm early. I hope I'm not.
No, not at all.
Shocking you.
No. Thank you.
Okay, great. I was afraid that I was going to get all the numbers wrong and take a long time. So.
Oh, well, we appreciate you taking your time to do this.
Yeah, totally. Everybody has a lot of free time now, you know?
Yeah, where are you at?
I'm in Greenpoint in Brooklyn at my cozy little house. And by that, I mean tiny apartment. Where are you? Are you in LA?
Well, San Diego. Yeah, just south of LA.
And I just want to add, this is Tara. I love your photos that you're posting from your apartment. Very nice.
Oh my God. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Love it. I'm going to be kind of in the background because I'm with the kids, but so sexy. Love it.
Thank you. You got to bring hope, you know?
Yeah.
Hope and arousal to all the people stuck at home.
I appreciate it.
Say hi to the kids.
I love it. There they are. Cool. So our podcast, I'm not sure if they told you anything, but our podcast is about how you got to where you are today. As far as, I mean, I know you have a really successful acting career and you've done Broadway stuff and you have an EP coming out, which is really exciting. So we wanted to kind of talk to you about that.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm here for it.
Cool. So were you born in New York, or did you move to New York later?
No, I was born in not even Portland, Oregon, but a smaller town than that called Gresham, Oregon.
Okay.
And I graduated as quickly as I could, which was a year early, with plans to move to New York. I was a hardcore dancer as a like young person, and it sort of helped me get out of school as fast as I could because I was like, I have a dream. Mm-hmm. And I knew I wanted to go to New York because of all of the great movies in the 80s. It's all I ever wanted or thought that I wanted. And I sort of found out that that wasn't necessarily true once I eventually did go to conservatory at SUNY Purchase for dance. And I was just like, I don't fit in. Mm-hmm. I don't know quite what is wrong about this for me. And slowly I realized that my voice was the thing that was missing in my experience with dance.
Oh, wow.
And I started by dabbling in spoken word poetry. And eventually I got my first dance job outside of school. And it was with this really cool circus, opera, baroque, burlesque company called Company XIV. And I wasn't the best dancer in the company. And I really wanted to keep the job. And I told the director I could sing. And at the time, it was totally a bluff. Like, my only singing experience had been in soul choir in college. And the director was like, fuck it, send me a tape. And I did. I sent him a tape of me singing Willow Weep for Me by my, like, kitchen window. And he gave me a part singing. And that part...
Wow.
Yeah, that part was reviewed by the New York Times, who said that they wanted to hear my album.
Wow. That is so cool.
Yeah, it was a very lucky situation, because I never would have taken music very seriously. And it happened to me. And without that endorsement from the New York Times, I never would have thought that anybody would want to write with me or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I have like definitely found my home and my voice a lot more pursuing artistry as a singer. Songwriter.
Yeah. Well, did you start writing after the New York Times kind of co-signed on what you're doing?
Yeah, literally. I had like a couple of things that I like improvised in my house that I had sort of fleshed out as songs, but I never expected to go anywhere. One of them is My Eve, which is one of my songs that's out right now. It's the first song I ever committed to any type of recording. But really I like sat down to write my first project. Because somebody saw that review and reached out and said, do you want to write with me?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's been I feel like I've catapulted in this identity quickly because I never expected it to be an option.
So how did you get into acting then? I mean, it seems like you were doing a musical or like you're dancing and stuff. And then
I know it sounds pretty crazy. I sound like a Renaissance person. I'm sort of like, I feel sometimes like a con man because I really did only a hardcore study dance. And then I just have sort of swindled dance into these other things that I love more and fit better. Mm-hmm. I got my first Broadway show by auditioning as a dancer and telling them, by the way, I can sing. By the way, I want to read for the lead. And they let me. And then I understudied the lead in Paramore, which was a Cirque du Soleil musical. And then after that, I was in Les Liaisons Dangereuses, which is like a super sexy Baroque type story, Dangerous Liaisons. And it was just a great fit because of all the other stuff I had done. And yeah, so acting, I knew I wanted it. I didn't go to school for it. I didn't get the degree. And I just like tooth and nail shoved myself in people's faces to get them to see that in me.
Wow. How did you know how to audition for stuff? Was it just all through doing the Cirque du Soleil type stuff?
Yeah, I mean, you know, as I went along, people started to hear my name and thought of me for things that I was really right for. So like sometimes people ask me like, how did this happen for you? And I feel like it's definitely a really, the truest story I could possibly tell is that I wasn't afraid to be exactly what I was. Like mm-hmm. being niche for me is what got me the things that were right for me. Mm-hmm. But then like I was considered to be thought of for, or continue to be thought of for the right things. I don't know. It wasn't like following the cookie cutter path that would lead me to any certain end, you know?
Uh-huh. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense.
So like, and the more practical answer is like, I had a dance agent who gave me really general dance calls. And then I like worked my way in those dance calls to find the people that I thought were better fits for me and advocated for myself over and over again. And then, you know, along the way, then more people will come on board as they see it happening, you know?
Yeah. In your acting career on like the Netflix show you're in, you play like a rock star in the show, correct?
Yeah. I basically play myself. I remember the day that I found, I mean, hopefully like maybe a little less sassy. I don't know. I don't want to give anything away. some of my friends watched the show and they were like, Kat, you're playing you, but a bitch. And I was like, fuck yeah, I am. But anyway, that show, when I first got the script for Trinkets, I read it. I was out performing at a gig. I was singing. I really like, also just to like say, I feel like the catapulting of myself as a musical person in the world has been largely supported by the New York arts scene and being able to actually learn on the job, like singing in that show and continuing to gig in places like, you know, like No More and Joe's Pub and stuff like that. So I was out at a gig. It was a Halloween gig and I was singing and it was like this awesome, tumultuous, like beautiful performance night. And then I got the audition like at midnight.
Wow.
in my email. And I read it and it was like, person from Portland is, you know, like sassy, whatever, and amazing music, blah, blah, blah. And I just read the scenes and it was flirting and it was queer and that was really important to me. And I was like, I don't know what they envision for this, but I know that it's me. Mm-hmm. And if they are willing to take the leap and choose me, I can tell this story with a lot of truth and a lot of passion. Mm-hmm. So anyway, then I just told them, like, even in my audition, I was like, I'm actually from Portland and I'm actually queer. So hopefully you see it in me.
So hire me.
It was really a match made in heaven. Yeah. Yeah. And then I don't know if you've seen it, but I feature my song King of Shadow in it and Birds, and I got along so well with Kiwi, who wrote it and also wrote some of my favorite things, like 10 Things I Hate About You. It was just really a creative marriage. And I feel like she continued to write like my personality into the show a little bit.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it was definitely a cool first show.
Yeah. So with Trinkets, you said that you got to play and perform those are your own songs in the show?
Yeah. There were songs I had written before the show even came around and hadn't released them yet.
So how did that happen where you were like, hey, I have these songs and we use these, you know, as the soundtrack or whatever?
Like pretty much exactly like that.
Oh, really?
they basically liked my audition tape and I got a call back and I was like, and by the way, this is my music and I hope you'll consider it. And they were like, oh my God, yeah, definitely.
Wow.
It was pretty much the dream, you know, like watching, it was like the Bodyguard dream or the Selena dream, mm-hmm. where the artist themselves actually gets to play their own music and live in a world as an actor.
Yeah, that's amazing.
But I definitely have to like throw a little shine on the show for also choosing to champion an artist instead of like asking them to sing songs that were already written or whatever. The whole soundtrack of Trinkets is like a celebration of independent musicians.
That's really awesome. And you have a second season of that coming out too, right? Pretty soon?
Yeah, I'm so excited for it to come out. It ends on a major cliffhanger for my character and the lead, Brianna Hildebrand, who's awesome. Yeah, and I know what happens next, but you guys don't.
Sure. Very cool. And you've also done, you did HBO's, you're on The Deuce on HBO.
Yeah, that was also such a dream to be a part of. It's a David Simon project, so the writing is just like chef's kiss, amazing, perfect.
Yeah, and everybody and the gets cast on board. Is amazing too.
Yeah, I like basically had a masterclass in acting, and that actually was my first like TV show. It was before Trinkets even.
Oh, okay, so that was first.
Yeah, it was. It just Trinkets feels like, you know, more of a recurring integral character situation. But The Deuce was the best first experience I could possibly have had because everyone involved is at the top of their game and also full of passion for the story. And the story is, you're so enveloped in it on set. It was like an amazing period piece, something I really believe in. I play a burlesque dancer who has so much pride and is like married to James Franco's character, but always throwing him shade. And like, it was just a really empowering role with a lot of stuff that I care about involved in it. And that's what, you know, like, it's the dream. It's the dream to not only get to act because you always wanted to, but to tell a story that you really give a shit about.
True, yeah. And you got to, you know, like you said, James Franco and Maggie Gyllenhaal's in that show.
Yeah, among so many other incredible people.
How was that? Was it terrifying? Were you excited?
Yeah,
like looking
at
the script and then seeing who's in the show, was that kind of like, whoa, this is like real?
I mean, I love to fly blind. Like all my auditions, I walk in and I like half read what it even is, because if I do, I'm going to piss my pants. I'm like, once you pick me, I'll look this up. But I think I just was like, I got this. I'm going to go do this. And it really did feel like somebody that I understood and believed in. And I was just like, I know I can deliver this character unlike anybody else. And yeah, I feel like in any art form, if you have faith in something other than yourself doing a good job, that carries you.
Yeah.
You know, I had faith in this story and I had faith in this character and I was in service of her. And it didn't hurt that everyone on set was totally lovely and that after I totally did my thing and took a risk, I got written further into the show and had more scenes than they expected for me to have. Like,
wow.
It was definitely a marriage in that situation.
That's really cool. That's really cool.
Yeah.
They wrote more scenes for you just because they liked what you're doing so much.
Yeah. And like a number of times, like I have this in my back pocket forever that George Pelicanos has told me a number of times, like, you know, this part was really small before we saw you. Like,
yeah,
I get to keep that for my first acting gig. And that's just, there's nothing like that, especially when, you know, from the outside, looking into the acting world, it can be so daunting or you're warned of so many superficial experiences. And I have read for so many roles that don't interest me, like that are point blank described as like hot girl who is hot girl yet interesting, or like Ed Hooker, she dies, like you know, there is a lot of like superficial garbage out there, but but there's also a lot of really, really great stuff, and if you're uncompromising, that's where you land.
Yeah, totally. I want to go back to your music career.
Yeah,
so you're on Broadway, you got the singing.
I was on
the Broadway. You got the singing gig because you said, hey, I can sing. They agreed. New York Times writes up about it. And so at this point, you said people were contacting you to write with them. And this is before Trinkets and all that.
I released anything?
I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's, yeah, that's before anything started, right? As far as,
yeah.
Okay. So from there, like what was the first thing that happened? Somebody reached out to you? Like what was the next thing?
Yeah. So the reason I'm being cryptic about this is because unfortunately I kind of got like lots of little, like young artists do. I wrote a lot of songs that I really, really, no, it's great. It doesn't have to be off the record. It's a good story. It's important. But yeah, there was like a miscommunication between me and the producer that I like really wrote my very first songs ever with. And those will never see the light of the day because, you know, I feel that I was taken advantage of and I'm not going to release those songs. So basically I spent a year writing some songs that were really important to me and close to my heart. And then I started over. And I think it was really, I was heartbroken at the time and I was confused and upset. I had never been like involved directly in an industry other than like the super philanthropic dance world. So I was definitely naive. And yet I often think about that as a really good thing because having not ever written songs ever in my life, like, yeah, I laid a lot of really great raw ideas down, but I also learned a lot more about what kind of an artist I wanted to be and what kind of a performer I am. I had time to develop myself a little bit more before I really emerged with a statement or the beginnings of a statement. And yeah, to this day, I have not put out an EP. I have just released singles. My EP is on its way. And I'm so excited to finally release it because I definitely took the approach after, you know, writing what I thought was my first album and letting it go. I took the approach of just like writing as many songs as I could. And I wrote with so many great songwriters. I have a handful of songs that I wrote with Justin Parker, who is an icon and also a dear friend who wrote video games with Lana Del Rey, which is like one of my, like flags, like flags on the moon. Like that's an amazing song. The song that I have coming out soon called Broken Heart, I wrote with some awesome people in Sweden, John Martin and Michael Zutron. And I had like a smattering of relationships and writers, and I took enough time to figure out what I wanted to say now that I really believe in this EP. And it really feels like an accumulation of all of the stuff that I've ever done in my life, from dance to like the stage experience. Because I think, like, from going from being a dancer to suddenly just being a songwriter, the studio at first felt like a really introverted place to me. It's like a room. There's no audience.
Sure, yeah.
It's oftentimes a tiny booth.
Yeah.
So a lot of my songs were super small. And then I had the and beautiful and intimate and sincere and vulnerable, which is a true aspect of my artistry. But then I had the awesome opportunity and experience of going on tour opening for LP.
Oh, wow.
For Sold Out. Yeah. That was my first tour. Like 2000.
That's so cool.
First tour ever. Like, how fucking spoiled am I? Like, it was so amazing. Like, somebody that I looked up to for not only, like, ability as a writer and a singer, like a crazy singer, but also like a queer icon, and that being sort of beside the point of all their talents. And yet on that tour I realized, like, oh, I haven't played 2000 seat rooms, and when I do, I become a different performer. I'm like the Freddie Mercury of myself.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, fuck yeah, it's right. And and I was like, I need to write songs for this condition. I need to write songs for the gigantic audiences of people that come from small towns like the one that I came from, who want to put their hands in the air and feel free. I need to write songs for the dancer in me who wants to just move in the room and feel free. And it's not always about like getting in my field. I sort of learned that I had a capacity for more of this pop side of things and like, yeah, courage. So that was it was really informative for me. And I'm glad that I didn't like pigeonhole myself by putting out my first record at the end of the day.
So the songs that you were playing when you were touring with LP, are those the songs that are going to come out on the record, or is that prior to?
Yeah, a handful of them. I've written so many, and it's going to be a smattering of things that I've held on to as super special things that I knew from the beginning I wanted to go on with EP, and also some newer things.
Cool.
But yeah, from top to bottom, it's just like the handpicked ones that I think belong together as a story, as a little opera. out of the like 100 songs that I have that I like.
That's cool. Yeah, really, really excited to hear it. I love the acoustic song you have on your website.
Which one?
I'm terrible with
names. For the Love?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, I'm so glad you love that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, your voice is so like, it's big, but it kind of gives me like a Halsey feel. I don't know if that's offensive. Sorry. But
no, totally like, not offensive.
Sometimes the tone, but I love it. It's a rad song. I really enjoy it.
Thank you so much. That song is definitely one I wrote after the LP tour. And it was also after like watching Justin Timberlake's like live concert on Netflix or whatever.
Oh, really?
It wasn't like directly informed, but something that I like about this song that I also like about Justin Timberlake's live concert is that, and like music in general, I aim to like treat music and theater like a camera, like a camera lens, and the aperture should have capacity to get really like tight and also really open in the same piece. And I like about this song that the verses are really vulnerable, just like super candid retelling of my coming out story, my mom's battle with cancer, and her partner's battle with that. And yet the chorus is just, you could never listen to the verses and still believe in For the Love and like dance to that, or never get sad when you listen to the song or whatever. I love how subversive pop can be in that way, that it can be an earworm or it can be a diary entry.
Sure. Yeah. Prior to jumping on the road with LP, were you performing around New York?
Yeah, for sure. Before I started writing like this whole batch of songs that will become my EP, I actually sold out Joe's Pub, like playing, who knows what the fuck I was playing. Wow. I don't know if I can curse on this podcast.
Yeah, you can.
That's okay, fine. Good. But I definitely played the shit out of New York. That's where I became a performer and a vocalist, is like in clubs and stuff like that. And I also, you know, had some Cat Cunning shows, and those like grassroots fans have been so cool to keep through my development as more of like a pop icon with more of like more theatricality and, you know, if you will, mainstream like joy.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you remember performing live for the first time? Like, I know you've done pretty much your whole life dance and stuff, but was singing in front of people for the first time different? Was it scary?
Oh my God. It still terrifies me every time. And that's why it's the one I've chosen.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I've gotten like a little bit better. Like there are some situations where I'm not nervous. And I definitely always like zone in. Like I think even my live persona once I lock in is like pretty confident. But actually singing is such a vulnerable act for me. Yeah. It's something that is like new in my life. I have so much control over my body. I could dance under any nervous circumstance, but like the throat and the voice is so vulnerable. Anytime I'm really sad or stressed, I get sick in my throat, like we do as humans, you know?
Yeah.
It's where you breathe. It's like where so many of your emotions are stored, and you literally choke when you're nervous.
Yeah.
But that's one of those things that has made me want to chase it, because it truly makes me check in and be courageous. And that keeps me interested.
I love that. It's really interesting when you do think about like singing and the voice, where it's, if somebody picked up a guitar and shanked a few notes or smacked the piano a few times, it's whatever. But it's like, if you sing and your voice cracks, or you just sound bad if you just can't sing and you're trying to sing along to the radio or whatever, like it's almost like you're more embarrassed of that.
It's so embarrassing.
Yeah, than if you sound awful on a guitar.
Yeah, it is so vulnerable, and everybody sings at some point, even if only to themselves, so everybody has a reference for when you do
right.
it wrong.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting that, like, yeah, any other circumstance it's like, oh yeah, well, who cares.
Yeah. And to be honest, like I said, I learned on stage, like I learned singing in a show. So I definitely started my whole career pitchy as fuck. But I think the other thing is that I had to learn that what I believe in as an artist is committing.
Sure.
I believe, and I know from my life on stage, that people feel what you feel. It doesn't really matter what the notes are.
Yeah.
So hopefully I've gotten a little bit better with pitch, but I also know that at the end of the day, it's not about being good at it for me. It's about telling a story. It's about being brave enough to give something back to all the people who come out to me. And that's a weird time right now to be even saying that, because we're all quarantined and everyone's like scrambling to find a way to still connect and to still value performance and performers. And,
I know.
Yeah. I don't know, man, but I think that I think that principle still applies in terms of just like choosing to put yourself out there in your life.
Yeah.
And yeah, I guess I am like, I'm prepared to live a life with lots of time falling down. I'm just prepared to make a fool of myself a number of times in order to be great eventually.
Yeah. Do you prefer, I mean, I don't even know if you can answer this question, but do you feel more in your element when you're playing on stage or when you're dancing or when you're acting in a show like Trinkets?
That's a really interesting question. They all come together for me. So I know I sort of was like, oh, I didn't know who I was in dance. I should amend that. I really, part of why I want to make music is also to champion the kind of dance that I believe in, to champion the kind of dancers with different bodies and diversity in general that I didn't see when I was trying to become a dancer. So dance still lives in my music life. And I feel very at home with those things coming together when I'm on stage. But acting and music both have their scary things and they're awesome. I'm riding a wave of creative clarity things. But they definitely complement each other and both feel very necessary to me as an artist. And I'm going to fight as long as I can to have an equal balance of the two things because it's super cathartic to go write my own songs and tell my own story and build my own community with music. But it also sometimes becomes this overwhelming pressure of me, like it's my business, it's my ego. And you'd think that acting would be the same, but actually, like I said, I get to serve a story that someone else wrote and I get to disappear into a character that needs me. So they really balance each other out for me psychologically. I can't really imagine only doing one of these things.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. Thank you so much for talking with me. I have one more question for you. Hopefully you can answer it for us. It's
sure.
Do you have any advice for aspiring artists, whether that be a dancer, an actor, or a musician?
Candlestick maker.
Anyway, painter, whatever.
I think the main thing is it's hard out here. Everybody's creative. So you have to look at yourself and decide whether or not it's something you need. And if you can live with the balance of a little bit of creativity, that's totally valid too. But that it's really important to just do you. If it's something you need, it's going to happen. And if you have something to say, just say it. Don't be afraid of skipping the line of like getting the right kind of headshot or learning how to sing a certain type of way. Like, be willing to fail, be willing to be specific, and don't stop.